In 1959, four major jazz albums were made that changed music forever. Miles Davis, Kinda Blue. Dave Brubeck's Time Out. Charles Mingus, Mingus Ahem. And Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come.
1959 was a very important jazz year for me and my own development and the evolution of jazz up until now and beyond.
It was a year that saw the biggest selling jazz album and single of all time.
Time Out was going where I envisioned jazz should go. I said, boy, this is fine. This is gonna work.
Jazz was pushed to new heights of innovation, beauty, and groove.
You know, the things would swing. Yeah, he'd lift you right out of your seat.
It was the end of the Eisenhower era, 2.5 children, and the white picket fence. In 1959, jazz is reaching white America in a big way.
Oh, why are they so sick and ridiculous? The brainwash and teach you hate.
Jazz musicians didn't really, like, join the Civil Rights Movement. The Civil Rights Movement actually joined them.
And with Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come, 1959 saw the birth of a whole new free jazz movement.
When you talk about somebody speaking through their instrument, like actually hear it as a human, that's Ornette. He changed everything.
1959 was a phenomenon. It was on another level. That's all you can say.
We don't get you.
When I play though, I'm gonna raise my horn a little bit.
Okay. Just you four guys in this, right?
One, five.
Ready?
Miles Davis, Kind of Blue, is the biggest selling jazz album ever made, shifting over 5 million copies. It regularly tops best jazz album polls, as well as featuring high in lists of the greatest albums of any category. Kind of Blue continues to convert more people to jazz than any other recording. All this 50 years after it was released.
Yeah.
And let's hear a little bit of it.
Right.
When they walked into the studio, they did not see this as their ultimate statement. They did not see this as the birth of a classic. It was a session that was scheduled for that day.
After Cannonball, you play again, and then we'll come in and end it.
They go over by the piano, and he's giving them instructions about the tunes we're going to play, you know. So, you know, there wasn't a whole lot of music. I didn't have any music at all. You know, just a piece of manuscript paper with some chords scribbled on it. Miles tells me, make this sound like it's floating.
Here we go. No title. Start again, please. Sorry. We gotta watch it because the noise is all the way through this. This is so quiet.
The first time I did it, the engineer said, the drums are making like a surface noise. So Miles hollered back at him and says, that's part of it.
Well, that goes with it.
What?
Amazingly, Miles and his band spent a total of just 7 hours recording Kind of Blue. All but one of the tracks are first takes.
Anytime they completed a tune, that's what they were going to stick with. You know, it really is propelled by the idea that first thought is best thought.
Try it again, Irvin.
We would be hard-pressed to find any album opener that can compare to the opening of So What. This misty, unclear idea of where is the music going, where are we?
The intro for So What, which totally improvised, had no time reference, no beat yet.
And it's the piano and the bass sort of having this little conversation, and out of this musical cloud comes the riff, the grand riff, the one that says, so what? Boom, ba doom, ba doom, ba doom, boom. And then just when the energy is sort of like getting to the point where it needs to be kicked up a notch, Jimmy Cobb comes in with this incredible cymbal crash.
When we got to the place where the solos were supposed to start, I hit the cymbal, and I thought I had overplayed it for the room. I thought I had hit it too hard.
But bang, it hits. You know, you can't plan on stuff like that happening. Miles' solo kicks off. So simple, almost like a whispered confession, you know, by someone very intimate to you.
When Miles did Kind of Blue, it opened up a whole new direction in jazz, a more introspective, a new way of thinking about the creation of jazz and the creation of jazz compositions.
Part of Kind of Blue's enormous influence on music is the legacy of the band members. Many of them went on to become leaders in their own right, like saxophone virtuoso John Coltrane. But Kind of Blue is defined by Miles' incredibly hip trumpet sound.
He had this sound that was kind of like a haunting kind of voice. It was really individual, very unique, very special. The way he plays, sometimes it makes you feel life so deeply that you can almost cry, you know. And it didn't really sound like a trumpet anymore.
Miles' trumpet technique on Kind of Blue was something he'd painstakingly developed since he first hit the scene in the late 1940s. Back then, the music had been changing.
In the 1940s, if you were a player, if you were an instrumentalist who was really starting to, you know, try and make the move, bebop was the music.
Bebop was a fast and frenetic style of jazz. It reflected jazz musicians' desire to be accepted as virtuoso artists, masters of their instruments. Bebop's greatest exponent was Charlie Parker.
Miles Davis is a very precocious musical youngster. What he really wants to learn is bebop. And where he's going to learn it is on 52nd Street and up at Minton's up in Harlem, playing with the bebop leader of that time, Charlie Parker.
Aged only 18, Miles became a member of Charlie Parker's band. As Miles traded solos with his hero, he was learning about bebop from the source.
Miles is not going to be a sideman for long. Miles, like many of the other musicians of that day, were trying to deal with the language of bebop. Where do we take bebop? Miles said, the music has become cluttered.
Part of his genius as a musician was that he edited what he heard Charlie Parker play. So if Charlie, for instance, used 10 notes to make a certain kind of a statement, Miles Davis might figure out how to use 3. Miles used what they call the harmonic bomb, that you hit this note that nobody expects to hit, and it has a greater power than just running up to the note another kind of a way.
There's a connective between these four artists, Charles Mingus, Dave Brubeck, Miles Davis, and Ornette Coleman, in that they're all dealing with bebop and the continuation of bebop. Where do we take this language? What do we do with it?
Another direction jazz took in 1959 was the rhythmic experimentation of pianist Dave Brubeck's Time Out. A highly unusual record, each track is in a different tempo and time signature. The single, Take Five, is in 5/4 time and built around a drum solo. Yet it rose up the pop charts, becoming the best-selling jazz 45 ever released. Brubeck had spent years building the lineup of his quartet that would go on to record Time Out.
I put together, gradually, this dream group. Because some bass players and some drummers didn't want to play in different time signatures, didn't want to follow where it went.
But Take Five drummer Joe Morello was originally unhappy coming into a band dominated by Brubeck and saxophonist Paul Desmond.
On a marquee, on any kind of sign, it would say the Dave Brubeck Quartet featuring Paul Desmond, and the other guys were nothing. It could have been zilch, you know?
I said, Joe, I'll feature you. So the first night he joined, I gave him a drum solo.
I did the drum solo in that place. Went wild and the people just stood up and clapped and all this nonsense. Paul Desmond, in the middle of the end of the solo, he just walks off the stand and runs in the dressing room.
And Paul said, either he goes or I go. And I said, Paul, he's not going.
Which was a shock, you know. He was a star in the group, not Dave, it was Paul. Well, he felt that way anyway. He didn't talk to me for about 5 months, you know.